guys, it's Aoife from Words of Clover and I am here to do my favourite books of 2020. Now, I actually made this job a lot easier for myself about 6 months ago because I already have a favourite books of 2020 so far video that I put up in July. So I'm going to link that above and below. This is following on from about July time, so I have about 13 books here to talk about and then the other books I enjoyed this year are in that video. So to get on straight into it, the first book I want to talk about is Wonderland by Juno Dawson. This is a book I have a full video review for as well. I really enjoyed this book. Juno Dawson is one of my favourite authors. She never does wrong for me. I just love the way she writes. I love the way she writes teenagers in particular. I think she has one of those rare talents where she's able to write teenagers really authentically without sounding, you know, like an adult writing teenagers. She understands young people. She understands how they think. She understands how they interact. And she does it so well. This book is actually a Alice in Wonderland retelling in a way, because we are following a girl called Alice who is actually a trans girl, looking basically for her friend called Bunny, who she's had a bit of a romantic entanglement with, and she's trying to find her. She can't find her anywhere. And through her search for Bunny, she ends up coming across this invitation to this extravagant party that's been held by her very rich school friends. This party is called Wonderland. And she ends up going there in disguise, and she meets a bunch of crazy characters like the Mad Hatter, Tweedledee and Tweedledum, and all these kind of famous characters from Alice in Wonderland. She meets all these type of characters when she's at this party while she is on this elusive search for Bunny. This one was just so much fun. Just the Alice in Wonderland Easter eggs in this were really, really fun, but also just learning about Alice, her life as a trans girl, like sometimes her struggles to be who she really is without judgment and without fear of someone rejecting her. She's also, I think, demisexual in this book as well. Either demisexual or pansexual. Just so much love about this book, and as I said, Juno Dawson just is able to write teenagers so well, but she's also able to write books that just flow really quickly and you just really get sucked into and you just keep reading until you're finished, and this was definitely the case for me. There's also bonus points for this one where I really enjoyed, it was like a really like small thing in this book, but I really loved Alice's relationship with her stepdad, which was just really sweet and really nice. And I think the more like healthy stepfather, stepmother, stepchildren relationships we see in books, you know, are good, because there is that negative, you know, trope of evil step parents, and I just really liked seeing her have a really good relationship with her stepdad. It was just really nice to see. The next book I want to talk about, I've actually talked about in a couple of videos recently, is The Gutter Prayer by Gareth Shanrahan. This is a fantasy novel set in this fantasy city, and this is a book where we are following three different characters who are basically at the start of the book, they're on this job together. And this kind of heist job together, and basically everything goes to shit and they end up getting captured almost, and it seems they may have been set up. Plan to destroy this monument ends up setting off a series of events within the city that kind of almost awakens these old gods, that also has a connection to one of these characters and changes her life, and she ends up suffering from these like hallucinations and dreams about these gods, and in a way they're trying to speak through her, and this whole thing like has this really, you know, big effect on the city and could completely change the future of this city as well. This is a great book for people who just really love fantasy novels. It's really well written, it's really well meshed together, there's a lot going on with it, as you can probably tell from that description. It's very hard to accurately describe what happens in this book, you just kind of have to read it and find out. But if you like books kind of like the Lies of Loch Lomora and Fountryside, I would really recommend this book. It's a fantasy book that doesn't take place like on a big journey, there's not this big expansive like world, it's kind of really focused on this particular city, and I absolutely love this book and I cannot wait to read the next book this year, so I really, really recommend it. Clap When You Land by Elizabeth Acevedo is obviously on this list. Elizabeth Acevedo is just such a brilliant writer. I love reading her books. I love taking that time to read a book in verse and remind myself how much I love reading books in verse, and this book was just absolutely beautiful. We were following two sisters, one from I think the Dominican Republic and one from New York. And they share a dad, but they don't know about each other. Their dad is kind of living two separate lives. And then he ends up being killed in this plane crash. They end up finding out about each other through following their father's death. And they're kind of going through this myriad of grief and confusion and anger at their father, while also, you know, like mourning the loss of him and also figuring out how to deal with this new sister in their life. And we're also seeing how the two sisters, because of where they were born and the circumstances they were born into, how their opportunities are so different and the unfairness of that as well. This was absolutely beautiful. like Elizabeth Acevedo, which is able to write things in this way absolutely beautifully. I love reading her writing so much. And if you haven't read A Book in Verse, I would definitely read The Poet X by Elizabeth Acevedo, but this one's really good as well, so I definitely recommend this one. The next book I want to talk about is a science fantasy book I loved this year, and that was Revenger by Alastair Reynolds. This is a like hardcore sci-fi, like, you know, we're miles away from anything that seems to have to do with Earth. We are in a galaxy far, far away. We are following these two sisters, Adrana and Fura, and they basically run away from home and they join up with this ship with manned by a man called Captain Rackamore. And what the ships do, these kind of piratey type ships, they're basically going to use the young girls. They have this ability to be able to read these bones, and these bones will tell them about these planets where there's these time pockets for these planets in these different galaxies, where there's only a specific period of time that these planets are able to be accessed by people. And then there's these ships like Captain Rackamore who go to these planets within this time pocket, go down to these planets and basically get treasure that they can sell, pirating in a way. And these girls end up signing up to the ship to do this job so they can go and become kind of like space pirates in a way. When they are there, loads of things happen and sets off a bunch of events, and basically Fura, who is the main character we are following, she changes from like a little girl to this like a badass woman from like the start to the finish of this book. It's absolutely amazing to see her character development in this book over the course of a few months, and she is just really, really cool. She does get a little bit annoying at times because she almost becomes too confident in a way, where, you know, you're kind of thinking that she is a little bit obnoxious, but I still just really love this book. It's really, really good for people who might like the kind of the type of writing in The Expanse by James S.A. Corey. The pace of those books and the different types of kind of, I don't know, planetary exploration and the different types of technology and stuff in those books is very similar in this book as well. It was one for me where it took me a while to get into, but then about 100 pages into this book, something happens that completely shocked me. I did not see coming, I did not know it was going to happen, and I was so hooked from that moment on because I just needed to see what happens. This is a trilogy, I think, so I will hopefully be continuing on with this trilogy in 2021, and I cannot wait because this was just so good. This was just so good. I mean, space pirates, you can't really get any better than that. Another book I love this year, I've talked about it a lot, so I don't want to talk about it too much right now, and that is After the Silence by Louise O'Neill. I have a full video review of this I will leave linked up above and below, the usual. This is a kind of true crime documentary book. We're following these characters on this island called Inishroon, and 10 years ago this girl was found dead, and the murder was never solved. And it's obviously 10 years later, this documentary crew has come to Inishroon in the style of these true crime documentaries that we've seen become really popular in the last few years, and they are interviewing all the inhabitants of this island, the families of those involved, to try and figure out what could have really happened. And in particular, we are following a character called Keelan Kinsella, who is at the very centre of this like murder investigation. Her husband was one of the top suspects of the murder, and it definitely seems like she might know more than she's letting on, but it's kind of like, who is she protecting? Is she protecting her husband? Is she protecting herself? Like, what's going on? What are her secrets? She's someone who's suffered a lot of like bad things in her life, and you know, you see that in her character, and you see the book explore that, particularly relationship, like, you know, abusive relationships, manipulative relationships, domestic abuse, things like that, are explored really, really well in this book. This insular community, what it's like to live on this type of insular community, how everyone knows everything. People who are, you know, blow-ins are never really looked at the same way as normal villagers, and it's just so interesting. I was really hooked on this book. It's real, like a lot of Louise O'Neill's books, it's a real Marmite book. People either love her writing or they hate her writing. I love her writing, so this book really worked for me. This is more of a mystery than a thriller. It's not really, you're not really getting all the answers you want, but sometimes it gives you more questions, but it's more of the why than the who, if you know what I mean, as well. So yeah, I really enjoyed this one, and I definitely recommend it for people if they want to try something different. The next book I really loved this year was Twice Born by Margaret Mazzantini. This is a historical fiction novel that is set, mostly set in Bosnia during the Bosnian War. We are following this Italian couple who originally met in Bosnia. They have their life in Italy. They're suffering from infertility, and then we know that at some point they ended up in Bosnia during the Bosnian War, during which they had a baby, and then the wife of the couple, Gemma, She escapes Bosnia with the newborn baby, but her husband is left behind, and we know that he never came back, he never survived. And now, I think it's about 18 years later, Gemma has arrived back in Bosnia for the first time since then with her son, kind of introducing him to his place of birth, and is kind of trying to find answers to what really happened to her husband. And it's also kind of bringing back a lot of memories, obviously, of her time during the war and the circumstances around her son's birth and their escape back to Italy. This was just so good. It's a book that you really do have to work at the start, because the first 100 to 150 pages is just the build up to Gemma's relationship with her husband and, you know, their journey, their infertility journey and things like that. And it's a little bit, you do really have to push through, and they're not the most likable of characters at times. This is also translated from Italian, so not all of the translation is as good as you would want it to be. There's some bits that are a little bit strange and just don't translate in English as well as they could, where I'm sure if you were to read this in its native Italian, it would be absolutely beautiful. This book, again, taught me a lot about the Bosnian War. I knew about the Bosnian War, but I didn't know some of the like semantics around it, and this definitely taught me things that I didn't know about it. Taught me some of the war crimes that happened in the Bosnian War, which were absolutely horrific. You know, just the loss of life. It's just, and the fact that this happened, like, when I was alive, I was only a baby at the time when this happened, but it's still absolutely extraordinary that it did happen in my lifetime, and it's very hard to understand. This is the type of book that has a plot twist that just, like, it just blows your mind. It reconfigures everything you think about the characters. It makes you look at the book, look at what you've already read in an entire new way. It's so good. As I said, it's one you have to work through. You have to push through it because of the translation and because of those first 100 to 150 pages, you know. But then once you get into it, you get into it, and you can't put it down until you have all the answers. So yeah, love this one, and it's one I haven't seen anyone else talk about. I know this because I know of this book, and I got this book because of my friend who'd read it and loved it, but I've never seen anyone else talk about it, and I'd love to know more people who've either read it or would like to read it, because I'd love to talk about it. No one would be surprised to see A Ghost in the Throat by Doireann and Ghriofa in this video, because I've talked about this book since I read it back in October, I think, about how much I just adored this book. My favourite book of the year, one of my favourite books of all time, one I will reread again and again and again throughout my lifetime. I'll probably get loads of different things from it. Absolutely brilliant. Won the Irish Book of the Year award as well. And hopefully we'll get a lot more awards in the coming year, because it deserves it, because it's brilliant. This is a memoir slash half memoir slash essay collection in a way from this author called Doireann and Ghriofa. We follow her as she is through multiple pregnancies that she has, her identity as a mother, her journey as a mother. And she also, at the same time, is becoming obsessed with this historical figure called Evelyn Dove, who wrote the Kina for Artillery. This is like a very famous kind of big song slash poem for this historical figure in Irish history called Artillery. And this is basically, she was his wife. And there's very little known about her in history, and Doireann basically takes it upon herself to find out as much as she can about this woman in history. And through it, there's just this really great gaze and great exploration into how women are remembered in history, particularly in relation to their male counterparts, and how women's history has often been erased to make room for the males in their life. And why has it been that male history has been often, you know, deemed to be more important than the women in their life? And it's just such an interesting look at women in history, but there's also such an interesting, like, exploration, as I said, of Doireann's own identity as a woman, and as a woman in history, as a mother, identifying with other mothers in history. And there's just so much about this book that's just so interesting. It's one that you really just have to read it to see if you like it. It's one that will either connect with you or it won't connect with you, I think. It's just such an ode. Like, this is in a way Doireann's Kina to Evelyn. It's her story for Evelyn, and, you know, it's her way of making sure Evelyn is remembered in history, and, you know, one mother gives back to another mother. And there's just so much love and hope and, you know, rage in a way in this as well at times, because again of how women have been remembered or not remembered. And yeah, I just absolutely love this. It's just, it's sensational, it's so good, and it's something different to anything I've ever read before, and I just can't wait to see what else Doireann comes out with, because I will definitely be reading it. But this is a book that will be very special to me for a very long time, and as I said, I can't wait to read this as I get older, as maybe my identity changes if I ever become a mother myself or decide not that's not for me. I will continuously read this and I will get more out of it, and I will connect to different things in it, I think. So yeah, really, really good. Enjoy it. I love it. The next book I want to talk about is Girl, Woman, Other by Bernadine Evaristo. This, again, is a book a lot of people have talked about. It won the Booker Prize. It was a joint winner of the Booker Prize, or not the Booker Prize, sorry, the Women's Prize for Fiction. And it should have been the sole winner, because this is great. This is a collection of stories that are kind of interlinked. Of these, 12 different people, mostly women, some of them non-binary, and we are following them as they are like women of colour, people of colour, growing up in Britain, what it means for them to be a British person of colour, just their life, their childhood, who they are. And this is just brilliant. I just love this. I love finding out about all these different people. I loved finding out how the different characters were linked, how they all knew each other at times, how they all came together at different parts in the story. And it was just so good the way Bernadine was able to write all these people, have them have such distinct voices, and for them all their stories. Of course, like, some stories were more interesting than others, but none of the stories were boring. They were all absolutely interesting, and I loved all of them. I read this in audiobook and I really enjoyed the audiobook, so I will definitely recommend that version of it if you wanted to pick this up. But I absolutely love this and it was great. So the next book I want to talk about is The Devouring Grey by Christine Lynn Herman, and this is here simply because I just had such a great reading experience reading this book. I read this book originally because I did a vlog where I let my boyfriend pick what I read. I gave him 3 different options. He picked this one because he thought it said it was a little bit like Stranger Things, and I just love this book. This is about a girl called Violet. Yes, Violet, who ends up going back to her mother's hometown, which is a little bit strange and mystical and magical. And she just starts to realise that when she gets there. And it seems that this town is connected to this kind of monster. And there are these 4 founding families of this town who have these magical powers that basically keep this monster at bay and protect the rest of the town. And Violet is actually one of these founding families. She might have these magical powers, but she just doesn't know it yet. And we discover more about these families, more about these magical powers, more about the monsters as we go on with the book, and as we, along with Violet, discover what the hell is happening in this town. This book, as a lot of people have said, is like a CW show. It's like Riverdale meets Stranger Things meets maybe a little bit of Sabrina or something like that. Like, it is so, so good. There's just so much, like, there's just teenage angst and magic and darkness, and it's just great. I really enjoyed the fact that there was some, a lot of the characters in this are queer in some way, including the adult characters, which I really enjoyed, which I haven't really seen before, particularly in YA. I just had a great time reading this. I devoured this book in over a day, I think, and I just really enjoyed it. And yeah, I just loved it, so that's why it's on this list. Another book I loved this year, I talked about recently, that was The Five by Hallie Rubenfold. I did a buddy read of this with Jade over Boho Bookworm, and it's kind of funny, she wasn't mad about this book, but I really, really loved it. And this is basically a non-fiction look at the women who were killed by Jack the Ripper, and it's also a look at Victorian society at the time, how people in London, in Victorian London, lived their lives, these like ordinary people, people with not a lot of money, like the working class people. And we look at these different women, like, from their childhoods to the point where they were killed by Jack the Ripper. And in a way, it's just Hallie is basically giving them their life back and giving them their dignity back and their respect back. And learning about these women, the like ups and downs of their life, the hardship they dealt with, the situations they ended up in, like, to the point where they were vulnerable on the street. Some of that, there's a real sadness to this book as well, because of how these women lived and some of the hardships they had to deal with. But I just loved learning about them. I loved learning about their lives and all the different ways that people in society at the time lived. I just thought the study of the time and the exploration and the research that went into this book was absolutely extraordinary, and yeah, Hallie Rubenfold deserves all the praise for this book because it is absolutely excellent. Next book I loved was The Pull of the Stars by Emma Donoghue, and this was just absolutely excellent. Again, Emma Donoghue is one of my favourite writers. She never does me wrong with the book. I always love her writing, but this one was just so good. It is set in 1918 Dublin. We are following a nurse called Julie who is working on a maternity ward in Dublin, in this hospital in Dublin, but she's specifically working with women who have been who are suffering from the flu, because there is a great flu epidemic. The Spanish flu at the time is rampant in the world, and obviously suffering people in Dublin and in Ireland are suffering from it. She's dealing with women who are about to give birth who are sick with the flu, and she's trying to look after them in a time when there was no modern medicine, you know, at a time when childbirth was extremely dangerous for women, let alone when they had the flu. Like, there was no modern medicine at the time, and the intensity I felt and the connection I felt to the characters when Julie was on this ward and when she was looking after her patients was just absolutely amazing. The way Emma Donoghue made us care about all of these people, and when Julie was away from the ward, I felt so anxious for the characters. I was waiting for her to get back to them. That's all I wanted. I wanted her to get back to the characters so she could keep looking after them, to find out if they were okay, because obviously their lives are literally on the line at a lot of the points in this book. If you like books like Call the, or if you like TV shows like Call the Midwife, you would really enjoy this, because again, we were seeing kind of how women had to give birth and some of the things that they had to do and what people, like the nurses, had to do to them to ensure like a birth that would, you know, be safe for them but also safe for the child. The way at the time nurses were treated by doctors, particularly doctors who were mostly male, who didn't actually know as much as they should have about the patients, how sometimes nurses actually do know best. There's also a character in this book who is was a real historical figure in Irish history called Dr. Lynn, and she eventually opened up this, I think, like this children's hospital for all people, and she's a character in this book, and she's the character who basically tells Julie, she's like, I know what you're doing, I trust you, like you are the best person for these women and you can do what you want, I will sign off on that. And she's an amazing character, and I really loved her. There's also the political feeling in Ireland at the time. It's World War One, just at the end of World War One, and you know, there is a feeling that Irish people shouldn't be fighting in World War One for England, because we should be fighting the English at home because we are being ruled by England, and there is obviously a very anti-English sentiment in Ireland at the time. Then it's also been 2 years since the Easter Rising in Ireland, which happened in Dublin, and there's a very different feeling on the ground to that at that time than there is now. Us looking back at it in history, we saw it as a turning point in history, where back then they didn't like it because there was a lot of civilian deaths at the time, and they blamed the freedom fighters for that rather than thinking it was a good thing. Obviously, they were very much affected by it in a negative way, so it wasn't looked at in a good way, and it was just really interesting to read about that. There's also a really lovely female-female relationship in this book that I loved, and I just absolutely love this book. 5 out of 5 stars and one of my favourite books of the year. The next book I really enjoyed was The Bear and the Nightingale by Katherine Arden. I loved this book so much. This book was just absolutely magical. I loved it so much, and the quality of the writing, the magic in it, and that was real subtle at times, this connection with the old gods versus the new gods, the danger like new gods and like Christianity and things can bring into a society that like really revers the old gods. And I just love the characters in this, I love the writing, and I loved like the winter magic that was in it as well. I just love this one so much, and I can't wait to read the rest of them. Then the last favourite book of the year I want to talk about is Nevermoor by Jessica Townsend. This is just magical loveliness, middle grade book that I absolutely thoroughly enjoyed, and it's about a little girl called Morrigan who escapes from a terrible situation, ends up going into this world called Nevermoor, where she is able to participate in these trials to be part of this society called the Wondrous Society. And she ends up finding out a lot of things about herself, and she is just part of this magical world. There's a lot of friendship and found family and love in this book. It was just such a lovely read. There's loads of like laugh out loud moments, just lovely magical moments. There was she lives in this like kind of magical hotel, and in the hotel, the room will change itself according to her personality and to her moods of the day and to the seasons and stuff. And it was just so cool, and I would love a room like that. So I just love those little magical elements of the book that were just really, really cool, and I loved reading about. So I absolutely love this one. So those are some of my favourite books of the second half of the year. And if you guys enjoyed any of these books, let me know. I would love to know what you guys, what your favourite books of the year was. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll see you guys again next time.